Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Dr. Duncan, for inviting me. This is my third visit here, and I tell you, this place never fails to impress me and surprise me. The quality of science that I saw today, the students, you guys really did a great job. So take a pat on the back. Fantastic. Thank you, Dr. Chakrabarty, because it's our association that has brought me here, and Dr. Killaru, because you've really chosen me to come. I feel very gratified. So today I'm going to talk to you about my research journey, how it started, a little bit about, since it's a student forum, you need to hear where I came from and where I am today. We're going to talk about HIV and drug abuse that go hand in hand. So life is a journey, not a destination. I began my studies, I studied in Baroda, India. It's on the west coast of India, and this is where our university is. From India, we both my husband and I did our PhD, and we were recruited at St. John's Memorial University in Newfoundland, which is the easternmost point of North America. We both came as postdocs, and this was again a chance coming. I attended a course in India, met one of the mentors there, and I said, would you mind giving us a reference? And the guy said, not a problem. And my husband and I got recruited. So networking, talk to people. You never know when whose recommendation is going to take you somewhere. So came to Newfoundland, worked in a totally different area than what I was trained in. That was fine. We all do that. From there, because both my husband and I were PhDs, when he moved, I had to move. So it's not a complaint, but it just tells you, you have to adapt in life. So from St. John's in Canada, we moved to London, Ontario. Again, a great career, you know, again, changed my research topic completely. But it was a good period, got a paper in Cell, and I was quite happy there until my husband says, I will not mention, we also moved to McGill. I'm cutting that out, but we came to Toronto. And in Toronto, he went into industry. I stayed in academia. And now, after all the research that I did, this was a person that took me in was going to do lung research. And I said, okay, I'll get started. Pathways remain the same. So I started work at SickKids, which was a very productive period. Was looking at neonatal lung injury and growth factors. We were training clinicians in the lab, which was a wonderful thing. All the fellows would come from Europe and all over the world and train in basic science. So this was quite a wonderful bench-to-bedside bidirectional research that was going on. Things were going mighty great, got the grants, I was happy, I was really doing well, until one evening my husband says, I'm moving to Kansas City, and I felt like a punch in my stomach. Said, no, I'm 40, I'm doing great, I cannot start my research again, because research is not like a banking job, right? You got to be trained in something. Anyway, Kansas, I was home for a year, I got pretty... What am I doing with my life? Kansas. And I approached a person who was doing lung research. This was a lady, a clinician. There were lab. I was the only person in the lab, and I really didn't like that. I needed more interaction. I said, what am I going to do? So I approached an investigator who was looking, was the czar of HIV, and I'll talk about him, Bill Narayan. He had moved from Hopkins. He had a huge lab, monkey work. So I approached him. I said, I would like to work with you. And he said, sorry, I don't have money. I said, pathways remain the same, you know, no experience, but at least I can help with something. Nope, I don't have money. I said, 50%. Nope. I said, okay, I'll do voluntary work. So that's where I made my switch, and I haven't looked back, because that's where I got interested, and HIV became my favorite topic. We started working on the brain, looking at the lung and various. So if there is a will, there's a way. You guys have to push yourself. And in science, there are no boundaries now. Cancer people are still doing signaling. You have to learn to adapt, because NIH comes up with RFAs, which are totally new. If you don't adapt, you're never going to get there. Great time in Kansas, got independent grants. I was really enjoying that period until Bill passed away. In 2007, and I was independent, but I had never got that being employed as an independent faculty. I had grown up from within, and I would have been fine with it. But then I got a call from Omaha, where Bill's colleague, who knew Bill, said, Shilpa, we are looking for somebody. Would you come? That brought me to Omaha, as you can see up there. Omaha, the good life, you know, I took that offer. I was 50. people were telling me, what the heck are you doing? You know, at this stage, my postdocs told me, are you crazy? You're moving, your husband is in Kansas. I said, look, I've never got this opportunity before. I'm getting a lab space. I'm getting startup funds. I can do whatever I want to do. So don't hesitate taking chances. Now, when I connect the dots, I said, whatever I did was great, because the way the career has blossomed in Omaha, it would never have. So I want you all to know that take those chances in life. You never know what's waiting for you. And if it doesn't work, you'll still have learned an important lesson, how to move things. So Omaha is where I am currently. It's a great place. We're doing good research. And that's where the work has moved. Now, he was my mentor, Bill. Always have a mentor in life. That's my key message to the students. You have, science is not a profession without its pitfalls. You know, there are rejections, there's negativity, there's a lot of things going on. You always need a mentor and a friend you can always go back to. So Bill was one of those for me. And what I learned from him at that time was passion for science. I mean, even at the age of 75, his eyes would light up like a kid in a candy store when he's looking at a slide under the microscope. So I learned that you can be passionate about your work. And one thing that will stay with me was, he said, when you receive a grant or a manuscript rejection, allow yourself 24 hours to feel bad and then chin up and ready to fight. So remember that, students, because science is a very arduous profession. You've got to be thick-skinned. And so if you don't do that, you're never going to succeed. And a lot of us mope. I have people that will sit for months if a grant rejection has come because they are feeling so miserable. But we are wasting that time. Get up, think about it. The reviewers are mostly right. And then you can write another grant or a revision of it. So clearly, nothing is impossible. The word itself says I'm possible, and you need mentoring. So keep that in mind. And some of the lessons that I've learned along the way, I won't dwell on it, but clearly, luck has nothing to do with it, is what I would say. You've got to push yourself. And sometimes being in a wrong place, having tough mentors is what really makes you drive and go to higher levels. So don't be upset. I think keep doing well, helping your mentors along the way, because you're going to learn the skills of running a lab. So without further ado, now I'll tell you about the science that we are doing. So another point I'd like to make is drug abuse. I was not into drug abuse. I have not been trained as a virologist. I have not done drug abuse. I went to a meeting in Keystone 15 years back, and one of the NIH program officers told me, why are you not looking at drugs of abuse? It's a problem with HIV. I said, I have no background. And he said, just add cocaine to yourselves. That is exactly what I did. And now I'm majority funding is from NIDA. So I'm going to talk to you about HIV infection, what it used to be, what it is now, how HIV and opiates and cocaine interact, and some of the different cell types of the brain. So HIV, what is HIV? I think everybody knows it's a human immunodeficiency virus. It is RNA virus. The virus comes in touch when a person gets infected through body fluids. It then comes and fuses with the cell wall on a cell that has CD4 or CXCR4 co-receptors, or CCR5. So there's fusion, the virus enters the cell, it sheds its coat, caps it, and it enters now, the viral RNA gets made into DNA by reverse transcriptase that the virus transcribes for, enters the nucleus, which is the blue circle, and it can stay there, latent virus, for life. So once somebody has HIV, they have it for life. You cannot get rid of it, which is a big problem currently. So in productive cells, like the CD4 T cells and monocytes, HIV comes out, making more progeny cells and virus, and you have a lot more virus in your body. So how is the chronology of this disease? When a person gets infected, you look at the red line there. Early with an infection, within a few weeks, they will have mononucleosis-like symptoms, high virus count, which is that red line, and they don't feel great. They have fever, they have shiverings and things. But we are all endowed with a good immune system. The body fights it, the virus comes down, which is a latency period, and the person feels pretty reasonably good, right? Now, if you look at the pink line up there, that is dropping. Those are the CD4 positive T cells. So the CD4 T cells drop also during that infection. There's a partial recovery, but if you look over time, there's a dropping trend. So the CD4 T cells are constantly dropping. So these people may appear fine, but they're really not doing great. And when the counts come below 500, these people start beginning having opportunistic infections like TB, zoster, simplex, and crypto. When the counts come below 200, now you have severe AIDS. They're really unable to, they've become skin and bones, diarrhea, and they have worse kind of end organ diseases of the lung, the brain, and all other organs. So we were interested in looking at, so again, what was AIDS prior to antiretrovirals? It was a death sentence. If you had HIV, you had 18 months post-diagnosis. Now people have antiretrovirals. They are living healthier, longer lives, and it's become a condition like diabetes. You know, you don't have to, chronic condition, take your medicines and you'll be fine. But these are toxic medications. You may not have opportunistic infections, you don't die, but then your body is constantly subjected to these antiretrovirals and what is now called the graying of AIDS. A 70-year-old AIDS patient or a 50-year-old AIDS patient starts looking like a 70-year-old normal patient. There's a lot of premature aging going on. In addition, there is involvement of a lot of organs. If you look at peripheral neuropathy, you see cardiovascular disease, diabetes, lipodystrophy, chronic pulmonary diseases, and what we're going to talk about today is HAND or HIV-associated neurological disorders. What is undergoing with these patients, there's a lot of inflammation. And that's true for a lot of diseases, cancer, diabetes. There's a lot of the viral proteins, the antiretrovirals, drugs of abuse, all cause inflammation in the body, causing changes in the brain and other organs. So this was a good article in New York Times in 2009 talking about normal productive people. Some were clinicians, some were lawyers. They contracted HIV and they couldn't even remember their own names. So these educated individuals, so there's really 50 to 60% of the people will have HAND, problems of cognition. And out of which almost 30% have a history of substance abuse. So if you smoke, you take alcohol, you take recreational drugs, because they are depressed, they're stressed, so they will take. So this adds to the burden of the disease. So we're going to talk about HAND. HAND is clinically characterized by motor and behavioral dysfunctions and cognitive impairment. It's not one entity. It's an umbrella term used for asymptomatic disease, minor cognitive, or other forms. So that's why it's difficult to study, because it's not one thing that we are looking at. The etiology, what we believe, looking at the patient brain sections is, there's glial cell activation. Your brain is filled with microglia and astrocytes. So the cells are activated because of cytokines and chemokines, neurons are getting degenerated. They're not dying, but they're getting injured. And I must tell you, neurons are not infected by HIV. HIV, they don't have a receptor for HIV, but they get damaged because of the extra products, bystander effect. A cytokine may be released, a viral protein is released, and they get affected. So if you were to look at the left side is the basal ganglia, the midbrain. That is the area that HIV has a predilection for in the brain. And this is a simple conceptual slide to tell you the blue cells are tight endothelial cells in the brain. The blood side has monocytes infected with HIV. And in the brain, you have all the cells. You have astrocytes, microglia, neurons. Infected cells can enter the brain early on, occasionally. Once they enter the brain, they release the virus. Virus can now infect the microglia, the cell in green. This cell gets activated. Its cytokines can go and activate the astrocytes. It also releases viral proteins, the envelope protein, the GP120, and TAT, which I will be talking about. And these proteins can now act on the neurons and kill the neurons. And that's how the HIV disease progresses. If you look clinically, what happens is the brain is shrinking. In people that have HIV, you see much smaller brains, atrophy. If you look at MNGC, which is a multinucleated giant cell, all the infected cells fuse together to form a cartwheel-like nuclei. That is a typical feature you see on a slide of a patient that has died of HIV, encephalopathy. There's microglia. Basically, there's a foci in the brain of infiltrating cells that are coming from the blood, and there are infected macrophages. Viral P24 protein is present only in the microglia, as shown on the right panel. NEF protein is present in the astrocytes. Astrocytes are not productively infected. And if you were to look at a tunnel cell, a cell death, it is mainly in the neurons. Why we have problems studying HIV? You have postmortem tissues. Although it's indispensable, it only gives you snapshots. You need an animal model to look at it, and the picture is clouded with opportunistic infections. Humans take all kinds of drugs, they have infections, and also multi-drug treatments. So that is not the best model to look at. You have difficulty in obtaining human specimens early after HIV infection. We really don't know what HIV does right after infection. We need an animal model to study that. And some cells, such as human neurons, are difficult to culture. So we really have to come up with some model. We have, in the field, come up with a lot of models. The best gold standard model is the monkey model, the rhesus macaques. The problem is they get the disease within a short span, within a year, which is great. We have viruses, not HIV, but SIV that we infect them with. The problem is that they are costing us $7,000 a piece. So NIH really doesn't provide us. We cannot do ends of 10. So people have come up with rodent models also. And the rodent models are transgenic. They express the viral proteins. So we are also using complementary studies. We do monkey studies. We do cell culture studies. We can co-culture the endothelial cells with the astrocytes. And we have in vitro models. And we can show tight junction proteins, how they are doing. If there is a leak in the endothelium, we can show it. So these are all the different models used in the field. So I'm going to today specifically talk about the extracellular vesicles. This is becoming an important area of research by NIH in the cancer field and also in all other diseases. What are these particles? So almost 30 years ago, people talked about these enclosed vesicles that are being released from tumor cells and tiny vessels. Okay, they were known, but people thought they're spewing garbage. And we just don't need to study about it. In 1980s, two groups, one working on both of them working on these, published back-to-back papers, one in Cell and one in, I think it was Nature or something, where they talked about these reticulocytes releasing these particles containing the transferrin receptor. So this sparked interest. What are these cells making? In 1987, there was a terminology that they talked, we knew about it, but exosomes were coined by Rose Johnston. Then in 1996, it wasn't until 10 years later that immunologists got interested. How are cells talking in the body, in the blood, you know? And then now it's escalated to the point where you look at the number of publications. We have a society for international society. We have American society. We have a lot of things going on because your cells are constantly talking. And in disease, they are talking even more. It's known, how does cancer metastasize? Probably a cell is releasing these particles that are going, talking to a text message to a cell in the brain and metastasizing the brain. So that's the belief we have. So under normal circumstances, you look at the left side, that is ACT periphery, you have activated macrophages, they're releasing these particles which are going in the blood-brain barrier into the brain, they're releasing, talking to the neurons, oligodendrocytes, keeping them healthy. But in disease state, there is some different message going so that now the cells are probably misbehaving and you have functionally impaired cells. So if you to look at these, how are these exosomes formed? There is invagination, ILV is intraluminal vesicles. From the endosomes, they just invaginate. They form little spheres inside. They get matured. If they have to be disposed of, they go to the lysosome pathway. Otherwise, they are released out at the plasma membrane and they carry a lot of messenger RNA, protein, DNA, and that's where the message goes to the target cell, which it should go to. So that is a secreting cell releasing all these particles. They go and dock on the recipient cell. They fuse with the membrane and they can also endocytose and you have release of RNAs and proteins. And that changes the function of the recipient cell. And this is how cells are behaving in disease pathogenesis. So what is the composition of these particles? This is a big field. Again, omics, you study a lot of systems biology. There are a lot of microRNAs, mRNA, long non-coding RNAs, DNA, and lipids. And so we are interested how these cells are talking to each other. In brain diseases, this is very important. If you look at Parkinson's, you look at Huntington's, you look at Alzheimer's, the disease spreads over time. How does the misfolded protein spread? So one of the thinking is that probably these particles are going from a bad cell or a secreting cell to a normal cell, depositing that protein, and now you're having damage to different areas of the brain. So neurological diseases are really functioning through a lot of this misfolded proteins being transferred through exosomes. So the opioid crisis, I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Why are we interested in studying it? The U.S. accounts for 5% of the world's population, but we consume 40% of the illegal drugs worldwide. 23 million people are struggling with drug addiction, out of which only 10% will get the treatment. And of these, 40 to 60% will go to relapse. And you guys know better than anybody. Today, I saw a lot of posters that drug abuse is indeed a big problem. There are 25% of babies born in who are in NICU, intensive care, that are born to mothers that have opioid problem. So we really need to, and it's being prescribed. People are taking painkillers left, right, and center. 90% of the people have zero treatment. There is no treatment for opioids. Deaths due to prescription opioid has quadrupled from 1999 to 2011. At least 130 people are dying each day due to opioid crisis. And why is it important for HIV? Because in 2015, there was an outbreak of HIV again, despite the antiretrovirals in rural Indiana, because people were injecting adolescents in rural area were taking these drugs. So clearly, it's a volcano waiting to erupt. We still have a problem of HIV ongoing despite the drugs. So we started the study. We said, let's take a group of monkeys, which is the best model, and took two groups of monkeys. So the bottom group, the group two, was the monkeys we made dependent on morphine for 9 weeks. So the morphine was given four times a day. It's got a half-life of 8 hours. If you don't take morphine, your body gets into withdrawal. So we had to give these monkeys four times, including the weekends, for a long stretch of time, very cumbersome work. We made them dependent, then we infected them. One was without morphine, that got saline. After 9 weeks, we infected them with a virus, which is like HIV. And now the beauty of monkey system is you can take the blood, you can take CSF days after infection, and you can study, is the virus going up, virus going down? And the question was, is morphine, person that takes opiates, are they going to have more virus in their blood? And the bottom line is we did find, if you look at the top panel of that image there, SIVGP120, the left panel is only virus, and the right four panels are SIV and morphine. There's a lot more presence of viral protein in the SIV and morphine group. If you look at V plus M, which is virus plus morphine, there's a lot more pathology of the brain. That little thing you see is a blood vessel. You see a lot of infiltrating cells coming in morphine group versus virus group. So morphine was potentiating the disease. We next decided, can we because all the drugs that you take in your body, whatever you are exposed to, the epigenetic change is going on. It's been shown nicely by people in Mount Sinai in New York. If the rats are given one dose before they mate, they are given cannabis, these offspring of these rats are going to have addiction problems. You can understand the damage cannabis or other drugs are doing if you just take them once in rats. So this is really a known field. Epigenetics is a big area and hot area. You know, you may be two twins are born. One looks much older. One looks much younger. One is raised in a farm. One is raised in a city. They may be working out, but the changes that are there because of the lifestyle causes a lot more. So this is an important area. So we looked at the microRNAs because microRNAs get transferred through these exosomes, and we could understand something about the pathology. Now, we've already shown in our previous studies, if you take an astrocyte in the brain and an astrocyte sees viral protein TAT, we're only focusing on viral protein TAT here in the brains of people that are infected. And now if they see morphine, these astrocytes are going to make these tiny particles that are like text messages. They carry the microRNA 29B. All the microRNAs have got, if a microRNA is going up, it blocks the expression, transcription of its target gene. So if 29, and you can do this with bioinformatics, you have programs to look at it. So we found 29B going up, and the target of 29B was PDGF. PDGF is just like BDNF that I saw today in a lot of talks. BDNF is a growth factor the neurons need. If this 29B is going into a neuron, it's going to downregulate its PDGF, which means the neuron is not going to have a healthy factor anymore, and that neuron is going to die. So one of the mechanisms by which HIV and morphine cause neuronal injury is via this pathway. We've already shown it. And our group at Omaha, we've also shown if you give infection to macrophages, just give virus to the HIV to the macrophages, you're now going to have microRNA 21 coming out in these particles. Neurons can take it, And the beauty is that these microRNAs can actually go and bind to the TLR. I'm sure you all know what TLR is. These are pattern recognition receptors in the macrophages, and they can bind and cause activation and necroptosis. So what are EVs? Just to give you a background, the field of EV is evolving. You have to characterize them by many ways. It's not just one thing. You look at under the transmission electron microscopy, you do a nanosite to look at the particle size and concentration, atomic force microscopy, and you also do Western blotting to look what are the signature markers of this extracellular, because they are membranes. So you can do CD9, Alex, and then you can also do activity of acetylcholine esterase. Multiple ways to characterize, because you have heterogeneous population of particles coming out. You want to be sure these are right particles, these are not apoptotic bodies or anything. So I'm going to tell you today about the story of morphine, how it causes downregulation of pericytes. So if you look at the left panel, that's your endothelium, lumen. Your blood-brain barrier is a tight endothelium. You see the cells around it. There are microglia, but there are very important cells called pericytes. These are fibroblast-like cells, very much neglected in the field. And what you see is, what has been known in the field is, the blood-brain barrier composing of microvascular endothelial cells, astrocytes, and pericytes are wrapping around these endothelium. They are like worms on a log. They are spaced very sequentially. They are important for formation and maintenance of your blood-brain barrier. When you have a lot of alcohol and you feel woozy, probably your pericytes are migrating away and your brain is leaky. There's leakiness going on. And this correlates with the endothelial barrier. The tighter the barrier, you may have infection in your periphery. It doesn't go to the brain always because there is tight barrier. If these pericytes are not there, you may have damaged blood-brain barrier. And as I told you, they appear like logs on ants on a log. And it's been known that they can actually educate the neutrophils to come in. They guide them, help them where to go in the brain. So they are really critical cells which have been understudied in the field. And our hypothesis was, if there is less pericyte coverage, suppose morphine is causing these pericytes to move away from the endothelium because of these exosomes, can now more monocytes from the blood enter into the brain and cause inflammation? Possible. So this is something we decided to look at. So the hypothesis is, that's an astrocyte on the left. If it sees morphine, is it going to release particles that have microRNA 23A? And we did all this by array analysis. 23A is known to cause downregulation of P10, which is a negative regulator of migration. So if you have 23A taken up by pericytes, it downregulates P10. P10 is going to make these cells, downregulation is going to make them migrate away. And now you will have detachment and migration. They could also release, forget the microRNA 9 for this talk, but HIV TAT protein could also release EVs containing microRNA 138. Now 138 has a characteristic of directly binding in the microglia to a TLR. And it can cause activation. So morphine can cause detachment, TAT can cause activation. All these things are going to cause problems in the CNS. So first thing we did was we took mice that were given morphine and we isolated the microvessels. We had monkeys and we took microvessels from the brain of these animals. Now we're going to stain them with PDGFRB, which is a receptor, and this is specific for pericyte marker. We also stain for CD31, which is a marker for endothelium, to see the coverage. And just to look at the panel on the right, in the mouse brain microvessels, morphine had much less coverage. There are less pericytes. Same thing we saw in the monkey brain. So we know something is going on. Now we have a mice that has got red color pericytes. The beauty of genetic techniques. So we took this mice, and now what we did was they were injected with morphine for 7 days. We really wanted to get rid of these pericytes, but we also wanted to see if we give them cells and can we these cells migrate into the brain and cause inflammation, because now the barrier is leaky. There is no pericyte. So we isolated wild type mice we used for isolation of bone marrow derived monocytes, labeled it, and we injected into these animals on the 6th day with a green dye. So now if you see the green color which you give IP into the brain, you know that because morphine caused migration, the barrier broke, and now you see a lot of green cells, which is exactly what we saw. There were more cells migrating in the pericyte mouse in presence of morphine. So the hypothesis was morphine upregulates microRNA 23A in astrocyte EVs, leading to reduction of pericyte coverage, and therefore there's increased blood-brain barrier breach and increased monocytes coming in, which leads to neuroinflammation. So this is, I already told you, I won't get into this. So the first thing was you take the monkey brains that have got morphine and see, are you seeing more 23A in the brain? This is not EV, this is total brain. There was more 23A in the monkey brain. In-situ hybridization was done, where you can actually stain, astrocytes were strained with 23A. These were the major cells making this microRNA. So we know astrocytes are the cells that are making this, and they give us a hypothesis for our cell culture work. When we look primary astrocytes and we gave them morphine, voila, we also saw a lot of 23A in these cells. Now we isolated extracellular vesicles from the astrocytes. Astrocytes given morphine, take the culture supernatant, isolate these particles, and there was more 23A. So we are going on the right track sequentially here. Now, are these 23A EVs, I'll call them, if I put it on a pericyte, is a pericyte going to take it or not? There are wonderful ways of doing it. You can take a transwell, you culture your astrocyte on top. The astrocyte has already got EVs which are labeled red color, cherry color. You put the pericyte down below. It's quite physically separated, but we actually saw the color being taken up by the pericytes. So it's actually migrating down and being taken up. This was one way of doing it. Now we also took the EVs from labeled astrocytes, put it directly on the pericyte. And again, we saw that they were taken up. So clearly pericytes are taking it up. Now, is it causing migration of these pericytes? That was important to look at. If they get taken up, what happens? So this is a wound healing assay. I hope most of you know about it. You get these inserts where there's that whole thing you see on top, cell suspension is added. The white thing is an insert. You let the cell spread. And in the third panel, you see you remove it. So now you've got a gap between the cells. Now, if I put any treatment, if the cells migrate, the gap closes in. That's called wound healing assay. And what we found is if you put EVs from control astrocytes, there's migration, but not a whole lot. But if you take morphine-treated EVs and put it on the pericytes, they migrate and that gap is closing. So there's migration going on. We can prove this by doing also another way we can do is transwell assays. You culture your cells on a top insert, you put EVs containing astrocyte EVs with morphine, and the pericytes will go down and stick to the bottom of that. You remove the insert, count the number of cells, and what we found is more cells in presence of morphine EVs versus control. Another way of proving migration. So to all the students, if you do your results, validate by multiple means if you want your paper to go in a good journal. And the third thing is looking at the organoid, you know, 3D model. You can take your pericyte and put endothelium, mix it with a matrix, and you can actually see these vessel-like formations. And what we found is if the pericytes had seen morphine EVs, the branching was not good. So they were not having a lot of pericytes. So clearly proved by multiple ways that this is what's going on. Now you go to bioinformatics and say, what is micro 23A targeting? And we found one of the thing is P10. It's a negative repressor of migration. So we said, if I give EVs from these astrocytes which have seen morphine onto the pericytes, if P10 is the target, P10 should go down. And if you look at the second panel, the lane there, you can actually see P10 levels are lower. If you were to give naloxone, which is a blocker of opioid receptor antagonist, which should block it, you don't see the effect. So clearly this is quantification. You're telling you morphine EVs are down-regulating P10 in the pericytes. What is going on in terms of signaling? You can do a whole lot of things with signaling. We found P10 going down. You can use, the beauty of microRNAs, you can use inhibitors, you can use mimics, you can validate your findings by multiple ways. We gave morphine, we found P10 going down. If I gave an inhibitor of 23A, now nothing is going to happen. And exactly what happened, nothing happens. If I give it a mimic, which mimics 23A, I again see it going down. So this is a very beautiful black and white way you can, it's not gray. You can, answer is yes or no. And we found this, and we found AKT signal was going up. So clearly what I'm showing you here is this is an astrocyte. When it sees morphine, it releases 23A, which is taken up by the pericytes on the blood vessel. They are now going to downregulate P10. If P10 is down, the cells are going to migrate. This is exactly where they migrate. We don't know at this stage. And because there is no coverage on the endothelium is now going to break apart. You're now going to have cells from the blood coming in and populate your brain, and you're going to have neuroinflammation. And this is exactly what happens, influx of monocytes. So these are reductionist approach. We are doing it. It's a big scheme of things. It's not one microRNA, but clearly you can get a good publication. You get a good idea. You can take families of microRNAs and see, is this what's going on and or not? So now there's another part of the story, which is microRNA 138. I'll quickly go through this. You're not only interested in morphine. We're interested because people are infected with HIV. What is viral TAT protein doing? So our idea was, these have gone through this. Now I told you microRNAs can actually go and bind to TLRs. This has been known in literature. The binding sites are GUGA kind of things, which ligand of TLRs have similar sequencing as these microRNAs. So the microRNA can actually come out, taken up by a cell, and it can bind to a TLR to activate a cell. You don't even need a bacteria to infect you. So this is the way the body reacts to inflammation. So what we did was we took these astrocyte exosomes and we said, do we find these sequences AUGU rich, which is what TLRs bind to? And we found a lot of these motifs in all the microRNAs. And the one that stood out on top is 138. So we chose to work with it. We know that this microRNA can actually have a sequence that binds to TLR. So if TLR is activated, NF-kappa-B will be up. So we took these microglia, gave them these morphine EVs, and now we look for activation of NF-kappa-B. And clearly, in presence of morphine EVs, there was a lot more activation of NF-kappa-B. You can do this by Western blotting. You see in the cytoplasm, P65 levels go down. In the nucleus, it goes up. So we are on the right track. Something is getting activated. Is it through TLR? Next approach will be you take TLR knockout animal cells. Isolate the microglia from knockout animals. It should not have TLR. Now, if you give morphine EVs, you're not going to get any activation. So beautiful tools available to do the work. We also did it by a lot of ways. You can, is it physically interacting with TLR7? So the microglia were incubated with EVs. Exosomes are now labeled with a red dye, CY5 microRNA, which is red in color. And you allow the cells to interact with it, taken up. Now I label the cells with TLR7 antibody, and I can co-localize the two together. So I know my microRNA is actually going and binding to the TLR. I can do RNA immunoprecipitation assay. This is, again, a great tool. You took the cells, you isolate the lysates, RNA binding proteins are there, and you can now pull it down with TLR7 antibody and now do PCR for the microRNA. And you will find microRNA PCR is showing upregulation with these EVs. So that's another way of doing it. A reciprocal way is also of doing it, this by doing Western blotting using biotin-labeled microRNAs. I won't dwell into this, but this is just validating our findings that there's a physical interaction between TLRs and microRNAs. Now, translocation, is it going on? We took, again, mutant microRNA, we took control microRNA, and you can see with microRNA, P65 is down in the cytoplasm, up in the nucleus, and the mutant fails to do it. Now, another intriguing story, I'm going to let your mind spark here, is long non-coding RNA. MicroRNA is only 20 to 25 base pairs, very small. Long non-coding are, on the other hand, 200 base pairs. These were thought to be junk RNAs in the cell. Nobody paid attention. Now they're becoming important regulators of the gene regulation. So whenever NF-kappa-B is up, this long non-coding RNA COX-2 goes up. You don't have to think much about it. Just think this is an RNA that is also upregulated during inflammation. So is it going up in our cells that are getting morphine EVs? Sure enough, we found with morphine, nothing added. You see that up red thing going up, long non-coding RNA goes up. If I give it a blocker of NF-kappa-B, which is SC514, or a blocker of TLR7, which is chloroquine, I'm able to abrogate the effect. So clearly, something is working through TLR. I told you we can take TLR7 knockout cells, which is the beauty of the system. Your cells have no TLR, so even if the microRNA comes, it's not going to do anything. And sure enough, you don't see upregulation of long non-coding. Now, how do you study what's going on with this long non-coding RNA? So the assistant professor in the lab, he had a great idea. He said, I'm going to block this long non-coding RNA with siRNA and see what genes are coming up or going down. And intriguingly, what he found was the genes for phagocytosis went up. So if you have high long non-coding RNA, phagocytosis is down. If you were to block the long non-coding RNA, now the phagocytosis genes are going up. So we came up with an idea that maybe microglia, the job of microglia like macrophages to eat up bad things, bad cells. And maybe because this long non-coding RNA is going up due to EV morphine, that now you are seeing phagocytosis being dampened. And clearly, this is exactly what we saw. If you have a knockdown of this, if you look at the microglia of this quantification here, with controlled siRNA, you see decrease in phagocytosis in the microglia. And you can give the labeled beads and do phagocytosis, it's an easy assay. But if you had siRNA blockage, you don't see that drop. You see a little bit, but it's still high. So this was telling us something is going on here. So now the idea came, can we do RNA therapeutics? Can we take this long non-coding RNA, siRNA, give it to an animal that is morphine treated intranasally, and see where does it go? So we did imaging studies. At 4 hours, we found just simple animal, wild-type mice, intranasally given this siRNA, and looked where it's going. And at 4 hours, we found it in the heart, the lung, the brain, the gut. At 24 hours, it was still there in the brain. We said this could be a good approach. When we killed the animal and looked at the brain's microglia were the cells that indeed had taken up this siRNA. So it's a therapeutic. You can give without invasion. Otherwise, giving things to the brain is a big problem. So the mice were treated with morphine 1 hour before for 7 days. 1 hour before the morphine, you were giving these siRNA. Now, if you're giving this in controls, you will see a lot of long non-coding RNA. But when we looked at the animals that got the siRNA, there was much less. So our vector was working. Okay. Now we got to do phagocytosis in the sections of these mice brain. You kill them, you take the brain, give them phagocyting, you know, beads and see how the phagocytosis goes. And just look on the right panel with control animals that were not given the treatment, you see phagocytosis is going down in the microglia. In the other animals, there isn't a change. So this is one way you can build the therapeutic. You can mix a lot of microRNAs and give therapeutics intranasally and it goes to the brain. So with this, I would like to summarize, and I think I've done it in time. Astrocytes are the major cells of making the exosomes. Other cells make it too. You could study microglia, you could study neurons, but the ease of getting these cells is what drove this experiment for us. So you take the astrocytes with morphine, they are making 138 microRNA in addition to many others. That's activating the TLR7. TLR7 is known activator. Cell is getting activated, NF-kappa-B, IL-6, TNF-alpha, all going up. There's increased activation and there's decreased phagocytosis. I told you about that. I didn't talk about microRNA-9. This is a published study by us. HIV protein by itself can cause increase of microRNA-9 by these exosomes. They can now downregulate an anti-inflammatory protein, MCPIP, and now you have increased migration and activation of microglia. So one drug is causing activation and decreased phagocytosis. Viral protein is causing and complementing the two, a host is going to have a lot of problems in the brain. So with this, I think I have left you something, you know, exosome research is fun research. MicroRNAs are black and white, as I said. You put it, you overexpress, you underexpress, you get the data very clearly. So they can be used for vesicular trafficking, you know, what's going on in the lysosomes, what is going on in the endosomes, and autophagy. I mean, that's a great pathway to study in the cell. How are these things connected? Why does cell make more exosomes? Is autophagy blocked? So we are looking at that. We could look at the role of exosomes in aging, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, in the gut-brain axis. Now we know that gut is your second brain. All the neurological diseases begin in the gut. The day you don't feel good, you're nervous about presenting, you don't feel good, right? I think it's all starting with the gut. And HIV hits the gut first. Drugs of abuse hit the gut first, and maybe they're talking to the brain, which then leads through these exosomes, something is going into the brain, and then they could be used as therapeutic. You could isolate from mesenchymal stem cells, put in your target therapeutic vehicles, and you can give it to the host that is diseased, and you can make these things as therapeutics to your advantage as well. And with this, I'd like to thank my team, the backbone, because I don't do the work. These are the guys that do it. We have great collaborations, both at NIH and of course, grant support from NIH. I couldn't do without that. And our patients, because I didn't talk about it today, but all of our samples, we have patient brains, we have patient PBMCs, and we can validate our findings from cell culture to rodent model, to monkey model, to human model. And I will stop here. Thank you. And I must add that I got the best questions in my last two visits from the students of this audience, in this ETSU. So don't disappoint me. Yes.
I was curious if morphine exposure permanently changes after size, or if you have to collect the exosomes while they're being exposed to morphine.
Very good question. I think we have not done, so we give them for 6 days. Chronic morphine is what people take and they get astrocytes which are damaged. And I think those studies need to be done. In monkeys, we have done that where we treat them for 9 weeks and then they continue getting, but you have to, you need constant morphine for them to really show it. And a longer treatment you do, then even when you remove morphine, they are spewing out these exosomes. But good point. But that's where you see people that take morphine develop tolerance. Same amount of drug doesn't work for them anymore. You know, they have to take higher doses. So that's what morphine is doing by injuring those cells. Good point. Come on. Can't be that clear. And no question is a dumb question, believe me. Yes.
In patients who use morphine and opioids for a while who aren't HIV infected, what we've learned from them on autopsy and other diseases that
very good question. So morphine has been shown in HIV patients. The question is that patients that are taking HIV, that are taking opiates and that are HIV infected, what are the other consequences of this too on the host? And clearly, lung is one of the organs. They have pulmonary arterial hypertension, most of them. The plexiform lesions are much worse in people that are taking antiretrovirals and opiates and HIV infected versus the controls. You have immune suppression in the periphery. You have a lot of gut dysbiosis, the translocation of the bacteria from the gut. So the gut barrier is getting all, epithelial barrier is getting breached. You have increased virus replication because the co-receptors are going up, CCR5 and CXCR4. And you have more neuroinflammation, you have cardiac arrhythmias, you have increased cancer. Unfortunately, not a lot of people are looking at opiates in other diseases, but it's so important to look at. Like they found in Parkinson's disease, they did data mining from people in Iceland, and they found that most of these people were on Ritalin, who now have Parkinson's. So we prescribe these drugs, you know, ADHD and things, but future long-term goals, you don't know what it does. So we need to understand that. Good question. Yeah.
I have a question. You mentioned that morphine induces migration of parasites. What's the parasite doing after the migration?
I knew this was, I knew somebody would ask that. We don't know. But the parasites have, it's you have to track them. You have to do a 2-photon microscopy, which we have not yet done, to really track where they are going. But parasites have the ability to get converted, differentiate into microglia. So we don't know whether they are terminally going and getting differentiated. It's a tough question, tough one to answer. But it's clearly would be nice to know where exactly are they honing into. Are they turning into microglia now, which are different? Microglia is not one microglia. There's so many types in the brain too. So that's a very, very good question.
In patients who have, who've been under excellent
suppression.
No detectable virus for 20 years. Yeah, 20 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is the fact that the events started before they went into treatment? Because there should be very little virus floating around. And not, where the HIV is coming from and what sort of is continuing that process.
Yeah, so, a very, very important question again. There's a belief that most of these antiretrovirals don't cross the blood-brain barrier. So the brain anyway is a low reservoir sitting there. There's low-level virus replication going on. But also there's a parallel belief that there's probably viral proteins because they are not impacted by antiretrovirals. So they themselves could be causing the damage in the brain. And these people may appear fine, but the damage on the brain is ongoing. Constantly. So EVs we haven't looked at because it's really difficult to get a lot of tissue from these samples. We can have frozen sections, we can do immunostaining, but really hard to get hold of. You need a lot of tissue supernatants to do EV work. But the damage could have been started. When they start the antiretrovirals is important. Now the thing is to start immediately, but a lot of people don't have that luxury. And the kinds of antiretrovirals. There are some increased penetrating ones that help, but then you have to balance it with toxicity also. So there's a lot of complexity of this disease. It's tremendous, yeah.
You talked a lot about opioids and their effect in perpetuating the HIV infection and damage. What about other drugs of abuse, like alcohol?
So cocaine causes increased oxidative burst. It's a very high oxidative stress inducer. It increases virus replication and also causes barrier breach, we have shown in our studies. Methamphetamine does the same thing. Nicotine, cigarette smokers who are HIV and on antiretrovirals have a higher propensity for pulmonary hypertension. So which is kind of sad, it's really disturbing. That despite antiretrovirals, you're having this. So yeah, cocaine does that too, and methamphetamine as well. And alcohol has been shown to cause breach of blood-brain barrier as well.
I was wondering, when you gave them the siRNA, I guess that's what you guys do, the nasal passage, so you said it's going to every organ, like most of the organs you mentioned. Have you ever looked? And in your technique, what's the concentration? How do you know, what are they getting? How much amount?
So we have not standardized it. But, considering that we put them in this position and we inject 5 microliters into each nostril, we wait for a while, and 20 micrograms of the siRNA is given. So we believe it's standardized, and then we count the cells and which are taking up. But you're right, it's not foolproof. And that needs to be standardized properly using various other techniques.
Well, the other question is, have you ever looked at, the effect on other organs?
No, we have not. We have just focused on the brain in this one. But you're right, where it goes to the gut and the other ones, it would be nice to look at. Where else is it going? Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have a question really about, we have some students, they started on the nose of function. So you use intranasal installation, they can go to the brain. Do you know how this
I think it's I don't know the details of it, but it circumvents the blood-brain barrier. And it just goes to an area where there is less tight junction proteins. And that's how it enters the brain. And intranasal is now becoming very popular for insulin delivery and things as well. So I think it's been a known nanoparticles people are giving through intranasal. Yeah.
Through the olfactory system?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. You're a great crowd. Keep up the good work.